I have the honor and privilege of introducing our fourth speaker for our speaker series at our campus, focused on equity and student success. Our speaker, Eddie Sain, has a lifelong commitment in serving the children, youth, and families in San Francisco Bay Area and beyond. Eddie immigrated to America from China with his family when he was 12 years old. Like many immigrant youth before and after him, he did not have a choice whether or not he wanted to come to the United States. First, he knows firsthand the difficulties, barriers, frustrations that young people in the community go through. Eddie's mission is to use his experiences to inspire and motivate young people to invest in their education, raise awareness about the detrimental impact that the prison industrial complex has on the Asian and Pacific Islander population, and to promote racial harmony amongst people of color. Eddie is the 2015 Open Society Foundation's Soros Justice Fellow, who will raise awareness about the impact of criminalization and deportation on the Asian and Pacific Islander community and ensure that their voice and experience is included in the larger movement to end mass incarceration in the United States. Eddie is had been appointed by the San Francisco Mayor Edward Lee to serve on the Southeast Community Facility Commission. Eddie also serves as a member of the San Francisco Board of Supervisors, appointee on the Children, Youth, and Families Oversight and Advisory Committee, Board of Directors in San Francisco's Chinese for Affirmative Action, and the Chinatown Community Development Center. He is the co-chair for the Oakland-based Asian Prisoners Support Committee. He is a consultant for the Community Youth Center of San Francisco branch office in the Bayview Hunters Point. In 2007, he led a book project which culminated in a publication of Other, an Asian and Pacific Islander Prisoners Anthology. Eddie is currently the subject of the soon-to-be-released documentary, Breathe In. I think that happened already, right?
Not yet.
Not yet? Yeah. Okay. So without further ado, Eddie Sain, thank you.
Happy New Breath, everyone. My name is Eddie Sain. I want to invite you to take a deep breath. Right? Please take a deep breath and feel that breath going through your lung, because that breath that you just took sustains your life. Let's never forget that. So as a mean introduction, I want to start out with a poem that I wrote a few years back. It's called Autobiography at 33. I'm 33 years old, and breathing is a good year to die to myself. Despite being mired in constant ear-deafening screams from the cage occupants, the triple CMS, the gang-validated dropouts, parole violators, lifers, drug casualty, three-strikes human beings, in San Quentin's 150-year solitary confinement, I don't want to start things over. At 33, I'm very proud of being who I am. I wrote a letter to a stranger who said that you deserve to lose your youth and not return to society until well into your middle age, after he read an article about me in San Francisco Weekly. Well, I told him that 100 years from now, when we no longer exist on this earth of humankind, the seriousness of my crime will not change or lessen. I can never pay my debt to my victims because I can't turn back the hands of time. I will not judge you. Whenever I think about my crime, I feel ashamed. I've lost my youth, and more I learned, the more I suffer, the stronger I become. I'm blessed with great friends. I talk better than I write because the police can't hear my conversation. The prison official labeled me a troublemaker. I dare to challenge the administration for a civil rights violation. I fought for ethnic studies in prison college program. I've been a slave for 16 years under the 13th Amendment. I know separation and disappointment intimately. I memorized the United Front Points of Unity. I love my family and friends, my shiro, Yuri Kochiyama, and a young sister named Monica, who is pretty, wanted to come visit me. Somehow, I have more female friends than male friends. I never make love to a woman. Sometimes I feel like 16, but my body disagrees. Some people call me a square because I don't drink, smoke, or do drugs. I'm a procrastinator, but I get things done. I've never been back to my motherland. I started learning Spanish, Escupio una poema en Español. At times, I can be very selfish and vice versa. I've never been to a prom, concert, opera, sporting event, or my parents' house. I don't remember the last time I cried. I sweated with the Native Americans, attended mass with the Catholics, went to services with the Protestants, sat and chanted with the Buddhists. My mind is my church. I'm spoiled. In 2001, a young lady that I love started loving me. It felt worse than losing my freedom. I was denied parole for the ninth time. I assured mom that I'd be home one day after she pleaded with me to answer her question truthfully. Are you ever gonna get out of prison? Well, the prison industry complex and its masses trying to control my mind, but it didn't work. They didn't know I was introduced to Che Guevara, Yuri Kochiyama, Parler for Reed, Howard Zinn, Frederick Douglass, Asada Sakura Bell, Hoax, Marie's Comfort, Malcolm X, Gandhi, George Jackson, Mumia Buddha, and many others. I had about 100 books in my cell. I was internalizing my politics. In 2000, I organized the first poetry slam in San Quentin. I earned my Associate of Arts degree, something that I never thought possible. Something that happened, I self-published a zine, and I became the poster boy for San Quentin. Sometimes in the 90s, my grandparents died without knowing that I was in prison. At 30, I kissed my dad on the cheek and told him that I loved him for the first time. I written my first poem. I called myself a poet to motivate me to write because I knew poets would set us free. In 1998, I was granted parole, then it was taken away. The governor's political career superseded my life. Sometimes in the 90s, I participated in most of the self-help programs. In 1996, I really learned how to read and write. I read my first history book, A People's History of the United States. My social conscious mind was awakened. In 1992, I passed my GED in Solano Prison. I learned how to take care of my body from 89 to 93. In 1987, I turned 18 and went to the pen from the Youth Authority, the youngest prison in San Quentin's maximum security prison. I was lucky, because people thought I knew Kung Fu. At 16, I violated an innocent family of four and scarred them for life. Money superseded human suffering. I was charged as an adult and sentenced to life with a possibility. No hablo inglés. I wish I could start things over. I was completely lost. At 12, I left communist China to capitalist America. No hablo inglés. I was spoiled. In 1976, I went to the demonstration against the Gang of Four. Life was a blur from ages 1 to 6. On May 29, 1969, I inhaled my first breath. So I wrote this poem when I was in solitary confinement because I wrote a proposal and signed it with some of my friends that was advocating for Asian American literature and ethnic studies classes and some of our rights to be honored. And we were taken into solitary confinement under investigation because we were willing to challenge the higher education of the learning, right, to be more equitable. Today, I wanted to share a little bit about my story, but at the same time, I want to share a little bit about something that people normally don't think about, in a sense, when we talk about folks that who are locked up in the prison industry complex, because we normally, who do we know that who are locked up in the penitentiary? People of color, right? Black and brown. That's the majority of people who are locked up. But the Asian Pacific Islander population is normally don't think of people that would be locked up in the penitentiary. So we titled this talk to be AAPIs beyond bars, right? Because we know we have folks behind bars, but we want to think about beyond bars. So the beyond bar is more has to do with mental than physical, right? How do we emancipate ourselves from mental slavery because none of ourselves can free our mind, as Bob Marley sings, right? So we want to expose that pipeline, the migration to the school, to the prison, to the deportation pipeline, but that change has to come from within, right? So to be the change within. So I'm part of the Asian Prison Support Committee that's based in here in Oakland, California, and the mission of the Asian Prison Support Committee, APSC, is to provide support for Asian and Pacific Islander prisoners and educate the broader community about the growing number of Asian and Pacific Islander in the United States being imprisoned, detained, and deported. We seek to address the challenge and challenge the root cause of this crisis, such as the deterioration of our educational system, the criminalization of our youth, and the lack of access to resources for low-income immigrants and communities. So some of our guiding principles are here because we feel that it's very important for us to look at how, as an organization, what are we gonna do, right? So some of the guiding principles is that grassroots approaches to national policy advocacy has to be based on the perspective of those people who are directly impacted. And also taking a stance to support direct impacted communities even is politically controversial. Coalition building. Among AAPIs and other communities of color, locally, nationally, internationally, we have to be able to support each other in that way. Transformative justice for all, we have to refrain from the good prisoners, the bad prisoners, the good immigrants, the bad immigrant narrative in our messaging, because we can't shame other communities so we can elevate our own community, you know, in one way. And what we strive for is restorative justice and healing and mass incarceration and labor and not mass incarceration. We want to invest in building solutions that dismantle systems that dehumanize people. And our work is based on compassion and commitment. So I want to share this quote with you from one of the prisoners who is a Samoan American that who is inside San Quentin State Prison. He said that when an offender truly understands the magnitude of their crime, they are unlikely to offend again. Right? So Upo is serving a life term sentence inside San Quentin. And he's participating in different self-help programs in the prison. And then one of the programs that he participates is called the Roots Program, which I'm going to talk a little bit about. But I want you to look at the fact that what he, from his critical thinking and from his transformation, that he believes that when an offender truly understands the magnitude of their crime, that they are unlikely to offend again. So I want you to just kind of look at the map in a sense when we talk about mapping this magnitude and we're thinking about pipeline politics, because we always frequently think about the school-to-prison pipeline, right, and that's it. Right, but I want to expand that a little bit. I want you to look at the migration to the school, to the prison, and to the deportation pipeline, and also looking at that with the lens of the class, race, gender, and sexuality. Because all those things are part of this creating this pipeline. Right? So I mentioned in my own story that I came to the United States when I was 12 years old. So when I came, it was a voluntary migration because my grandparents thought that it's good for me to come to the United States and for my siblings to come for a better academic future and better career in the United States than what we had in China at the time. So, but yet I didn't have a choice whether I wanted to come here or not because that choice was made for me, right? So that's voluntary migration. I came here as a legal permanent resident. Whereas many of the Southeast Asians that who were forced to come here as refugees because of the imperialistic war that the United States have and the Europeans have in other people's country. Specifically, what we talk about is the Southeast Asians, right? With the Laotian, the Hmong, Cambodian, Vietnam. So those people are forced to migrate from their homeland and be displaced and coming to the United States, right? So when they come here, what they get displaced in different areas, they're displaced in different violence, poverty-stricken areas where they have to live. So now, not only do they have to deal with the trauma of war, but then when they came here, they didn't get a chance to even heal, have that healing process. They're thrust strictly into the community where the immediate three challenges that they have faced as immigrants or refugees is language barrier, cultural differences, and generation gaps, right? So then when they get into school, what they face normally is a lot of bullying that is happening, a lot of schools are not friendly, a nurturing environment for them to learn because they're from a foreign country. So with the system in place is not really welcoming to new immigrants to come in the school system, right? So a lot of times, that if they fell through the crack, and then that's hence they go into the criminal justice system. And then as the criminal justice system happens, they go straight into the prison system. And in prison, that's where they have to deal with another layer of trauma, you know, as a result of all these conditions that is, you know, that they have to endure. So now they have to go deal with the prison system. But that's not over, right? So normally when the people say, oh, you committed a crime, you hurt people, we send you to prison, we punish you, and we want you to come out to be a better person. Well, if you're APIs, if you're Asian prison support, I mean, you're Asian Pacific Islanders or other immigrants that come to this country who are not citizens of the United States, in the 1996 anti-immigration law, Illegal Immigration Reform Act, Responsibility Act, is that if you're not a citizen of the United States and if you committed a crime of aggravated felony or crime of moral turpitude, that you're automatically detained and deported, right? And it's retroactive. So we want to look at just kind of going through it. We look at the class, the race, the gender and sexuality, how that impacts the people. So the model minority myth, the model minorities and the mass incarceration, the making of the invisibility, the community stigma and shame. So when we talk about the Asian and Pacific Island population, people think about those people are very successful, they're hardworking, they're good at math, they have it made, right? They've been here a long time, they're good immigrants, people that do well. So that's this stigma saying that the APIs are successful. But yet when we talk about coming through mass incarceration and mass criminalization and deportation, we don't think about the invisibility that the people have to experience, because in my situation, for 14 years of my life, my parents never told anyone that I was incarcerated because they felt ashamed, that I brought shame to the family, because the fact that I was in prison, that is a shame to the family, so they didn't want to tell anyone. So that is consistent with a lot of folks that who are in the Asian and Pacific Island community. That cultural shame and the stigma, then it creates this layer of invisibility for the people that who are locked up inside. And then the reproduction of the invisibility, the incarcerated racial other, is that when we are locked up in the prison system, you're either black, white, Hispanic, or other, right? So it doesn't matter what other country that you're coming from, if you're not fitting that black, white, Hispanic category, then you're other. So now we became this other population that who is isolated in here in the way, because people always think about black and brown, right? So that now we became other inside the prison system. So the invisible impacts of the model minority stereotype is that because of the model minority myth, we don't, in our own community, we don't acknowledge a lot of challenges, a lot of things that is happening in our community. Therefore, we are not able to advocate for the adequate, equitable, and culturally competent resources to help these people to overcome those challenges, especially for people that who are locked up, that who are being deported. They don't get the support from the community, from our own community, but let alone the mainstream community, right? Because they didn't know that there's no statistic that demonstrate the fact that there's a big population of Asian and Pacific Islander inside, because we are all lumped as others. So there's no disaggregated data to represent that, right? So I just share a little bit about a narrative, like an anecdote from Simon, who is a part of the program in San Quentin, the Roots program. It's about punishing the model minorities, adult sentencing. So he said that, "I remember vividly that day I was forced into adulthood on my 18th birthday. My name was called in the juvenile detention center where I had been for the previous 2 years after I committed a robbery at the age of 16. It is a common practice to take kids who got sentenced to adult prison terms from juvenile halls to prison on their 18th birthday. Little known cure practice of our civilized society to determine when a teenager is fit to face his consequences as a man," right? So that's the difference between when we look, how do we look at teenagers as adults, and how do we look at adults as teenagers, right? In a sense that in Simon's case, when he turned, he was sentenced, he was a juvenile lifer, right? Juvenile life term, who's serving a life term. So he committed a crime when he was 16. He was charged as an adult and sentenced to life, right? So when he turned 16, when he turned 18, he went straight to the adult prison to serve his time. And it means that, now you're an adult, so now you're fit to be serving adult time and being in an adult facility. Whereas if you look at today, the transitional age youth, we call people transitional age youth all the way up to 24, you're still considered as a transitional age youth. You're not an adult, right? Just because the brain development, because of psychology, because of all the makeup. So now, but if you was committed a crime, we can charge you as an adult and sentence you as an adult and treat you as an adult, right? So we want to look at the adult sentencing and how do we focus on the people of color and the minorities in that way to kind of highlight this hypocrisy of our system in how to say that who are the adults and who are the youth and who are the people that they're fitting to be sentencing what. So if you look at the statistics in some ways, the violent non-white youth arrests tried in adult courts is 2 times more than the whites in California, right? So we just look at about the non-whites and the whites in comparison. If you look at the percentage, you see, you know, the Hispanic is at a higher rate, you know, the Asians, the blacks, you know, and all non-white categories, the youth, then there's 37% of the whites, right? So you can look at that as a statistic. And then we also look at the black Asian youth tried in adult courts and in prison more often in California, right? So the black and Asian, in comparison, you know, in dealing with imprisonment in an adult court in California, you can see some of the statistics that demonstrate that it's higher than other folks. So the roots to roots, the model minority prison transgression from solitary confinement to institutionalization. This is a picture taken in San Quentin State Prison in June, out in the courtyard where a lot of churches, the worship areas there, and then what we're directly facing is the adjustment center where the worst of the worst prisoners supposedly are being locked up inside. So we had a national convening from people from policymakers, foundations, grassroots organizations, national organizations all coming together to visit this program called the Roots to really look at some of the programs that are working in there to help healing the intergeneration trauma and healing folks so they learn how to take responsibility for the action and become a better person, you know, as a result of those programs. So the acronym for Roots is Restoring Our Original True Selves. And this program, the name, came from the prisoners themselves inside because we want to be able to, when we provide a program in our community, you know, we often want to use the youth development framework. You know, we don't want to tell the youth what to do, but we want to ask the youth what we can do to help support them, right? To invest in empower them. So the same idea, we want to do it with the prisoners inside, and that's why on every step of the way, they have a stake, they have a process in there to include them, to teach us and tell us what they needed from us to support them, right? So what the Roots focus on is the historic context of trauma, the cultural content, the humanization, and the healing and transformation. So I want to share a little bit about another narrative that from this Roots participant, Cam San. So we talk about the other identities, right? So he said, I remember being disgraced by my classmates because I'm different. They made fun of me because I'm Cambodian. My name was the subject of their queer games. It happened after recess when all of us students lined up outside the classroom waiting to go back inside. While we waited, a Mexican boy stepped out of the line, walked up to me holding an empty soda can. Cam San, this is how your name really sounds like. He marked and threw the can onto the floor. So this is a refugee, a Cambodian refugee that who in a classroom, you know, with folks as a young person, then he gets ridiculed, right? So this is part of the bullying that I was talking about in the school system. So how do people reclaiming their trauma inside, right? How do we do that to deal with the intersection of gender, sexuality, and class when we saw that map earlier? Is that, you know, from Tran, his experience was, so he shares in this narrative, so before Roots started the program here, I met Mr. Nick Lopez from time to time, and we had our little conversation here and there, you know, the regular hellos and goodbyes. But in Roots, we share our life stories. And when I heard his life story, it completely changed me as a person. Mr. Lopez shared with us how he had to help his mom to sell flowers at the age of 9 in order to put food on the table for his family. He had to endure all the verbal and physical abuse because he was a flower boy. It was so bad to the point that he lost his self-esteem. And when I heard that, it touched me so much, it hit home. So many of the young people, because or where they come from, and because of the environment they are, sometimes they are forced to do things they don't, what they have to do to put food on the table. Just like what's happening, unfortunately, in many of the people color community, is like people have to put food on the table, right? So that means if the parents can't do it, the kids have to do it themselves, And if the kids can't work, don't have the education, the opportunity, the equity to get a job or get educated, they're gonna do what they can do to put food on the table for themselves and for their sibling, right? So it's the same when it deals with the Cambodian refugee and the Vietnamese refugee and all the Asian Pacific Island population, is that when you think about the intersectionality of gender, sexuality, and class, we think about people calling him a flower boy, look at that as degrading someone from even trying to survive, you know, and it's talk about, you know, how the classes, the different systems of class that you have to endure a certain type of ridicule because of that. So we also talk about intergeneration trauma, and we talk about the intersection of generation, gender, and sexuality. And Tran also said that in this quote right here, he said, after the war was over, my family struggled so much that I had to follow my dad to help him sell coffee and put meals on the table for my family. It was a nightmare for me every time that I had to go deliver coffee for the customers. Because of my looks, kids my age, and older, sometimes even adults, often beat me up for no reason. I was often ridiculed with the remarks such as, your mother is a whore, that's why you look like that, or your mother F an American, that's why you came out like that. Right? So this ridicule and this continued psychological abuse for a young person had to endure in that way because he has to help out at home to help his parents, help his father to sell coffee, deliver coffee. Now, in that struggle, in a sense, for adults, because of the trauma of the war, they have a different mindset in that way. So now the way that they treat their kids and the way the other people around in the community treat their kids impacts them detrimentally in many ways. So that created the intergenerational trauma, you know, due to different wars and due to different traumatic experiences. So that's part of the Roots program, but for the Roots to reentry, you know, we believe that besides the people that who has to work on inside the system, but they when they come out, they have to be supported when they come out. So we have a program called the Roots to Reentry, where people, when people come out, we have the program on every Saturday to help these people to reimmerse back to the community. But the way that we use it is we want to use transitional education and housing advocacy. So many people spend 20, 30 years of their lives locked up inside prison system. When they came out, they're lost, you know? So sometimes they want to be able to try to find housing, but they don't know. Normally the system is setting up in transitional housings, but you can only stay there for so long. So we're trying to help them find housing, education opportunities. Then we also use cultural and cross-cultural community immersion as a way to get people engaged in the community. We take them out to the different volunteer services in the community, different fairs, events in the community, so they're exposed to different events and different cultures. And then we also advocate for labor and living wage to support them so they can be on their own. Because many of them, after they locked up for so long, they came out, they don't have support from their family anymore because they're elder. Right? Some people are 50, 60 years old, and the family member, they're not there, so they have to be on their own. So we're trying to provide those type of culturally competent services to help support the people coming out. So for me, you know, when I mentioned at the earlier beginning, we say be the change within, I want to say, you know, because I always say that we must be willing to engage in a personal revolution before we can embark on a collective revolution. Now, we're in this room right here. What is this room? So what do they represent?
Integrity for the people,
fighting the self-determination. But now they all have to have their personal revolution and personal transformation and realization before they can advocate for a collective revolution, right? And that's what we all have to do, you know? So that transformation and solution and self-politicalization and personal transformation and activation has to start with yourself, right? If we don't start with ourselves and we don't have the narrative, we don't have the understanding and the critical thinking, then we're not gonna be able to be out there to engage other people and try to convince other people and empower other people that we have to fight against the system that is oppressing us. Right. So things that we can support, you know, as a community, you know, some of the things that is happening in our community is that ban the box, right? So President Obama was able to issue an executive order to ban the box because of the advocacy from Dorsey Nunn, from All of Us and Nunn, and from the LSPC, you know, the Legal Services with Children, Prison with Children, and other community organizations from the formerly incarcerated people's movement, right? So they were able to advocate and do the ban the box. But even though the order was issued, we still need people to take action in the community to make sure that it's happening. And giving the formerly incarcerated people an opportunity, or the people that who have committed crimes or felonies before, have the opportunity to even get in front of for an interview, for a job interview, right? So, and then Proposition 47 was able to, you know, allow the people who had nonviolent crimes to be able to have an opportunity to be getting the support in the community instead of being incarcerated and getting into programs, and which save a lot of money to help support crime victims, support education, and support reentry programs and educational programs. Now, Senate Bill 260 and 261, the 260 is allow people that were sentenced as adults to life sentences have an opportunity to be able to go in front of the parole board so they can have evaluated, because, you know, at some point they are not the same person anymore, that they should be able to get released. And the 61 extend to the people that who to the age of 22, right? The 260 only extend to people who are 18 years old, but now the 261 extend to people that who are 22 years old when they were sentenced. And Proposition 21, we knew that it criminalized young people that was passed, you know, about 7 or 8 years ago when they passed Proposition 21. Actually, more than 10 years ago, they passed the Proposition 21. That's that they can charge as young people, as young as 12 years old, as an adult, right? If they commit a certain type of crimes that fits that. So we want to repeal that. We want to change that. And Pell Grants for the currently and formerly incarcerated. Now, it's proven through statistics that people with higher education inside the prison system, they have a very low percentage of recidivism. However, in 1992, they took away the Pell Grant. So there's no program for people who are locked up to have higher education programs. So we want to bring that back, right? We want to advocate to bring that back, because we want people to be able to get educated, to be able to change their mindset, to be out here and not recidivate. And that's a campaign that's going on right now from the Southeast Asian Freedom Network out of the East Coast. And they have a video campaign to change the repatriation agreement with Cambodia and the United States government to look like the agreement that they had with the Vietnamese government and the U.S. government, which is that in Cambodia, the people have been deported back to Cambodia, right? That who came as refugees to this country, they came, sometimes they even never been to Cambodia. All their lives they've been in the United States. But because they were refugees, they're not citizens of the United States, then when they committed a crime, they were sent back to Cambodia. So they go back to, they went to a country that where they didn't even know, right? Because they grew up in America, they Americanized, right? So we want to be able to change that to be able to, because the Vietnamese agreement is that after 1995, when they have the normalized relationship with the United States government, the people that came prior to that, they cannot deport them. The people who came after, they're still able to deport them, but in the meantime, they're trying to advocate the Cambodian repatriation agreement to look similar to the Vietnamese agreement, right? So things that you can get involved to, you know, you can check out the website, the Asian Prisoner Support Committee.com. You can write to us, email us. I have a website, even though it's not really updated. I'm trying to get that updated more frequently. And then you can email. I got my Twitter account there. You can. So, you know, how much time do I have? Let me see. I have some time? Good. So, now, normally, I can just keep going on and on, right? But today, I want to be able to engage you a little bit more, so I want you to ask some questions, right? I want to have a dialogue with you, because in that process, I'm able to talk little bit more about some of the things that is going on, right, with myself and, you know, what was happening with this prison industry complex and what we're doing. So, questions? Yes, sir.
First, I'd like to say welcome home, Andy. I truly understand where you're coming from because I actually spent 26 years in California Department of Corrections straight. So, I understand the dynamics of what you're saying when you talk about life sentences and how that going before the parole board. But earlier, you was talking about that statement of shame that you experienced when you're going through that journey, that visible journey of prison. But what I want to know is, once you reached your freedom, was that statement of fear and shame still associated with you and your family and your peers? Because that's really the biggest concern of how your family feel. And in fact, like you say, he's gone 16 years. 16 years is a long time to be away from your family. So when you really come back into that, which is a whole other society, and try to blend those, I'm a good person now, I'm in puns. It's kind of complicated, I can imagine. Was that complicated for you?
Yes, thank you for the question. I feel that for me, I'm just someone who is visible to talk about that kind of culture shame, right? But there are people that who are not visible, that who experience that culture shame and the stigma, they don't have a voice, right? So when I was inside, I wanted to have a relationship with my grandparents and with my relatives. But because of my the culture shame, because the shame that my family, my parents specifically, that they felt that I brought to the family, that they didn't want to talk to anyone about it. So here's my mom always said, you know, in the holidays, like we just had Thanksgiving. So during all the holidays, the family always got together, you know, to host, like each family hosts a different holiday. So we all came together and chill, right? So every holiday I was always missing. And the relatives always asked, where's Eddie? And so when I was in my teens, my mom would say, oh, Eddie's in school. So he's busy, he can't come back, right? He's in a special school that he can't just come back, right? And then we say, oh, okay. And then when I got to my 20s, then every year goes by, they say, oh, how come we don't see Eddie? He said, oh, Eddie came back over the weekend. They just miss you, right? You just missed him. And so he went back to school again. And then, you know, when I got older, they say, oh, Eddie's in school and working at the same time. Now he's out of state. He's not in California anymore. So it's always this is, Eddie's busy, he's in school, he's working. It's this trauma, this kind of like a chanting, this sutra, my mom just keep chanting them, right? So at one point I asked my mom, when I was in San Quentin, I asked my mom, I said, look, mom, I want to tell, you know, my grandparents that I'm locked up in prison. I want to know about their history. I want to know how they came to the United States at a young age, what kind of experience they had, right? So I want to learn that history. So my mom said, hey, your grandparents think that you're doing well, right? But they're happy right now. But they, you know, they're not very well. They're elderly, you know, they have heart problems. Now we tell them and they get upset and die. Do you want that to happen? And of course, I'm not gonna be the cause of their death. So I say, okay, so we just let it be. So subsequently, my grandfather passed away, my grandma passed away, not knowing that I was in prison. Right? So that's how deep that cultural shame is. And that's just part of it, right? We have other folks that who I know inside, they get disowned by their family because they committed a crime, because, you know, they did harm to other people. They brought shame to the family. They disowned them. Right, so that shame carries on for me in a sense that I say, how come they won't let, so now I have no relationship with my relatives at all. Even though after I came out, I still kind of, I went to one of my cousin's wedding, but we don't communicate because, you know, it was 21 years. You know, I was a kid when I went in, right? So, but here's the irony of it, is that after I came out, I immersed into the community, I work in a nonprofit, I work in the community youth center in San Francisco, do a lot of violence prevention. You know, I was part of this team in the community. So, you know, working a lot of things. And the more I work, you know, the more I really
appreciate the work that I do and using my own experience because I have instant credibility with people on the streets, you know, in all different communities, right? It doesn't just concentrate on the Asian community, but, you know, in African American, Latino, whatever community, I'm good, right? So, and then I start getting a lot of awards from, you know, different organizations, and then and I'm on the newspaper, on the TV, so my parents would call relatives, not only here, and their friends, not only here, but in China, right? And their friends in China, they say, oh, Eddie just got this award from the mayor, you know, from Boat Hall in Berkeley, you know, so now she's like calling everybody, right? So she's proud. She's proud that I came out, you know, I did well, but yet, before that, she was ashamed, right? So that's the same situation with many of the people who are in our college campuses right now. Because when people get to Ivy League school, you know, one of the good schools, man, everybody's bragging. Everybody's calling, everybody's saying, hey, you know, my daughter just got into this college, my son just got this. But yet, if they would have gotten into prison, or if they want to come out as LGBTQ, or if they're undocumented, or if, you know, people don't want to talk about it. They say, oh, let's not talk about that. Or if that's domestic violence at the home, or that's mental health challenges at the home, and in the community, we don't talk about it, right? Because it's just a known practice in some ways that we don't want to talk about the bad things. We're only going to talk about the good things. So therefore, in many ways, that contributed to the model minority myth. It means that, oh, all these Asian, they're all good. They have no problem, right? Look at them. Man, you know, they got nice houses, drive nice cars. So that's the kind of like a two different sides of this culture shame, or how do we deal with that, right? Yes. Yeah, so for me, so the question is that do I have open communication with my family and my parents? My parents, they love me. My family, I have an oldest brother and older sister, they all love me. That's something that I'm grateful for. All the time that I spend locked up, they were always there, right? So even though they don't tell people, but they always visit me, they always send me packages, they always show me emotional support. So we have great communication. Even out here, especially out here, they support everything that I do, right? Because I'm on the right track, and they feel proud and they feel good, right? So I think, you know, that's something that I'm grateful for, because when you're doing a life sentence inside, you know, one of the worst fear, right, for me was that I would not be able to see my parents alive. Right? I wouldn't be able to get out to see them alive. So when I got out, I'm able to see them alive and being with them, you know, that's something that I appreciate, right, that I don't take for granted. Yes. Yes. Yeah, I'm still in my capacity as a consultant in the Community Youth Center in San Francisco. So we started a branch office in the Baby Hunters Point, right on 3rd Street. So that's the change of the dynamic of the population is because of gentrification, there are less African Americans, right, in San Francisco, you know, now than ever before, right? There's probably like 4 to 5% of African American left, if that many, right? Or that much percentage. But in Bayview, there's still a large population of African American, but even that has been the African American pushing out of that because of all the development and all this gentrification going on over there. But yet, that was a lot of immigrants, Asian immigrants, that are going into the community, right? So now there are more Asian Pacific Islanders in, you know, the southeast part of the city, you know, than any other population. But then there's a lot of cultural differences, so it creates a lot of different tensions, a lot of misunderstanding. So therefore, that's why I wanted to start that office over there, is to be able to engage in the leadership program for the young people, right? Because we want to invest in young people. So we have a multicultural youth leadership program there. We also want to engage the monolingual Chinese population that have no services out there, right? They normally get their service in Chinatown. They'll take the hour bus ride to Chinatown and come back just to get some services because, you know, there's no services out there, right? And the other thing I want to do is promote racial harmony through cultural exchange. So every February, we celebrate Black History Month and Lunar Year because it falls on in February. So we have toy giveaways for all the kids, cultural performances, breaking bread. You know, we just bring people from the community together. And then we also started the Baby Solidarity Tour. And when we took the tour from people to learn about the culture of the Baby Hunters Point and African-American migration, you know, as a result of the World War II, so people, they learn about those, right? So we talk about what you said earlier is that when we took them to this Adam Rogers Park, this gardens by this African-American organization, the Hunts Point Families, they have a Girls 2000 program that they empower young people from ages 8, the young girls from ages 8 and up to help them to do gardening and find a space to really, you know, get in touch with the earth, right, and have a safe space for them. So when we took there, Brandy, who was the director at the time, Brandy Mack, and we were talking about how to grow the plants, how to grow the vegetables, and we talk about cross-cropping, right? So how many of the vegetables and plants and herbs we need to be able to put them together, you know, in the same pot, in the same area, so they can grow more vibrantly, right? So human beings are the same way, right? So the way that we do cross-cropping, that's the same thing we do in the diverse communities. How do we understand and learn about each other's culture and celebrate, you know, our commonality, embrace our differences so we can grow stronger as a community, so be there to support each other. And that's how we live, right? So I think in that way, that's how ideally that's what we need to do in our community. But for me, it's as an other, being categorized as other in the prison system, it's almost similar to that because the fact that we are neutral, right? So we are neutral in many ways. So the blacks and the whites and the Latinos, there's always this issue with this gang or the separation by these people. So with the blacks, even though they all categorize as blacks, but then you have to be, they'll check your affiliation. So are you a blood, a Cribs, you know, what sect you from, right? Or if you Hispanic, you know, you Latins, you know, Daniel, Sereno, MS-13, brothers. So this, all these categories to separate people. So the way, and we're all isolated, right? Inside, we're racially segregated inside a prison system. So when you're racially segregated, then it's tough for us to be together trying to advocate for something because it's the method of divide and conquer. It's how do we have better control of these people is by separating them. Because the system does that, and we do it ourselves too. We self-segregate, right, because of the ignorance, because the indoctrination of this colonization that is indoctrinating us, so we allow the system to do that to us, but we do it ourselves, to racially segregate ourselves, so we can come together. So once I was able to learn how to read and write and think critically, then I was able to really connect with different cultures and learn about their history and learn about things to enrich me and our relationship with each other, right? So that's why I'm cool with everybody. You know, I can go to any neighborhood and go, hey, you know, this is who I am. I understand what's going on, and I want to learn about what's going on. So, you know, it's about humbling yourself to be able to expand your horizons, expand your knowledge, right? Any other questions that people have? Yeah, so I was a juvenile lifer too. I was charged as an adult at the age of 16 for the crime of kidnapped, commit robbery and home invasion robbery. So it's myself and two of my crime partners. So the crime took place in San Francisco. So after I spent time there, the system that you have to have go to in front of the parole board, right, to be able to see you're fit to be released to the community. So when I went to the parole board, 1998, I was granted parole. And after spending 12 years locked up, I was granted parole. But at the time, Governor Pete Wilson was leaving office and Governor Gray Davis was coming to office. And when Gray Davis came to the office, essentially he took my date, I took my parole date. Even though the parole board had unanimously approved my parole to be released, but they still took my date because politically he wants to release no one, right? So then I had to wait all this year until Governor Gray Davis got recalled, and then Schwarzenegger came into office, and with the advocacy from the community, all the support from the community, I had hundreds of support letters, petitions. So I was finally getting another chance to get parole in 2005, right? So I was granted parole, and I was released from 2005 after spending 19 years in a state prison. But after, I'm thinking, okay, I'm gonna be going out, I'm gonna, you know, go back to my family and community, start to work. Then Department of Homeland Security came pick me up when they released me out of Solano Prison. So I never stepped foot outside a prison. The federal government came pick me up because I'm not a citizen of the United States. So they detained me and then ordered me deported. So I spent 2 years in Yuba County fighting my deportation case. So people say, Eddie, you did 19 years, right, inside a prison. Now you're free. Why are you fighting to stay? Why do you want to be doing more time and fighting your case? You just leave. Your freedom is more important. We'll say, well, my life is here, my family is here, and this is all I know, right? So I fought and I lost my case after I spent 2 years. So after spending 21 years locked up, I lost my case. I said, you know what? I'm gonna leave. And then the Chinese government did not issue a travel document for me to go back to China. So they had to release me on supervision. In the meantime, I'm fighting my case in the courts. And eventually I was able to win my case in the Ninth Circuit. And now it's sending back to the immigration court. And I just received a pardon on Easter Sunday from the governor, right? So it's something, you know, it's very difficult to get a pardon, but I was very fortunate with the support from the community that I was able to receive a pardon. But that does not help my deportation, right? They help a little bit. I still have to do my post-conviction relief from the district attorney's office in order for me to take care of my case. So I've been fighting for this fighting against this deportation case for the last 10 years, right? So I'm still waiting for that time where I can say, you know what, let me get my status back and maybe I can apply for citizenship, right, in the community. But in that time frame, it's about it's a process, right? That's a process that I get. So I was able to, you know, get out because of the support of the people, but most importantly, like I mentioned earlier, is that I was able to make that change within. That I was able to become mentally free because before I was physically free. And it's through education, that's why I attribute my my success and my transformation to education, right? That's why it's so important for us to invest in the young people, you know, in their education and build a foundation for them. And when we talk about the school to prison pipeline, we really need to think about prevention. You know, this series is called, you know, in dealing with about equity, right? Success and equity. You know, how can you have success without equity? You know, and how can you say that we are equal, but yet we don't have the equitable resources? You know, so that's how we have to really engage in this thinking of when we have the opportunity, how do we take advantage of it? And when people don't have the opportunity, how do we help advocate for them to have the same opportunity? You know, that's why I always trying to advocate for investment in education, because we already know that the locking people up is not working. You know, they spend more money locking people up than in investing people's education, and yet we allow them to do that, right? So that's why it's, we have to work on that. So any other questions? Questions? Say, yeah, well, questions, pretty please.
How can we support you in your case?
Well, for me right now, it's more so of having, how do we, so my case is left to at the government, like the district attorney's office and the government. As soon as they take care of that, then I'm good, right? So in the meantime, you know, to support me, the way you can support me is that you become successful, right? Because how do you invest in yourself, and then because of your investment, that you can help another individual. And then so we can have a stronger community, right? So that's how you can support me, is to continue to learn and grow and to engage other people in conversation, to talk about issues that sometimes we may not be able to see eye to eye, but yet we can agree to disagree, or we can learn from each other, right? So I think that's important. But had I have a strong campaign, you know, that going, then I would say, yeah, please support me in that way. But definitely supporting a lot of Senate bills, and this, you know, it's about being civilly, it's about civil engagement. How do you have civil engagement, right? So let me read, I think that's what we lack of is that civil engagement. I'm gonna read about, you know, this definition of the working definition of civil engagement, right? Civil engagement is acting upon a heightened sense of responsibility for one's community. This includes a wide range of activities, including developing civil sensitivity, participating in building civil society, and benefiting the common good. Civil engagement encompasses the notion of global citizenship and interdependence, right? We talked about cross-cropping earlier, right? And then through civil engagement, individuals as citizens of their communities, their nations, and the world are empowered as agents of positive social change for a more democratic world. Civil engagement involves one or more of the following: learning from others, self and environment to develop informed perspective on social issues, recognizing and appreciating human diversity and commonality, behaving and working through controversy with civility, participate actively in public life, public problem solving and community service, assuming leadership and membership roles in organizations, developing empathy, ethics, values, and sense of social responsibility, and lastly, promoting social justice locally and globally. That's civil engagement, right? So we all learn how to do that, then we change the world. That's how we change the world. And we can't do that unless we start with ourselves and start making that change from within. Other questions? No? So I want to share this poem with you. I want to share this poem with you that I wrote, but I need your participation. I need your help in this poem right here, right? So when I say, imagine, I want you guys to say peace, love, and community. Can we do that? All right, so I know this room is a little echoing, so you can really like shout it out, right? So let's try that. Let's try that, see if we can, because whenever I say, imagine, I want you to say that. Say the same thing, right? So, imagine.
Peace, love, and community.
Okay. I hear a lot of voice out here, a little bit over there. So I know we have more people, so now you have to make up for it, right? So I say, imagine, you say?
Peace, love, and community.
Okay, that sounds a little bit better, all right? So let's do that one more time. Imagine.
Peace, love, and
2015 Student Success and Equity Speaking Series, a time to congregate, celebrate, appreciate the power of narrative and knowledge. In the historical Huey P. Newton Bobby Seale Student Lounge. In the 21st century, you would think that there would be peace and harmony in the US of A, yet everywhere I look, racism, violence on the streets and in the homes, police brutality, racial profiling, homeless people, poverty, gentrification, mass criminalization, mass incarceration, mass deportation of people of color, wars on other nations are still orders of the day. Imagine.
Peace, love, and community.
How can we empower young people to understand that they are worthy? How can we inspire young people to comprehend that they are somebody, that they are the future? How can we as a society recognize that we have the responsibility for each other? A, B, C, F, O, B, Do, Re, Mi. No matter how you call it, we are all immigrants to this land of the free. We are all immigrants. Do you know where you come from? We are all immigrants in this land of Native Americans. Do you know where your parents, grandparents, and ancestors are from? We are all immigrants. If you don't know who you are, you better ask somebody, do you see what I see? Indisputably, we are all citizens of this earth. Ah, imagine. You know, back in the days, the African-American slave Frederick Douglass wrote his way to freedom after he learned how to read and write by any means necessary. Today, you afford an opportunity to an education to take advantage of it, because knowledge is power, is the foundation to your success, don't you know? There is no easy way in the journey of life. Embrace your struggles, overcome your obstacles, get up where you fell down, because the more challenges you take on, the stronger you will become. So respect yourself and love yourself. After all, no one can change you unless you're willing to risk changing yourself. Please, give love a chance. Give peace a chance. Give education a chance. Give community a chance. Give yourself a chance. You have the power to make history, so maximize your potential and be the best you can be. Represent. Not only are you representing yourself, you're representing your peers, family, culture, because you are the future, because you're powerful, because you're beautiful, because your life is a miracle, because life is beautiful, and if black lives doesn't matter, then none of our lives matters. Ah, imagine. Just remember, every move you make, every breath you take, every single day, the community is there with you every step of the way, because there's no power like people power, power to the people. There's no power like woman power, power to the women. There's no power like youth power, power to the youth. Ah, imagine.
Peace, love, and community.
Ah, imagine.
Peace, love, and community.
Ah, imagine.
Peace, love, and community.
All right, that's...
sharing the message. Thank you so much. Before you leave, we want to invite you to break bread with the community here at Merritt College. So please interact with the students, and everybody's welcome to.